Rather, thank you for the opportunity to get back to you and take what was just collected and glorify your name. And give Pastor here the words we need to hear, the words we need to live out for the rest of the week, not just for today. In your holy name, amen.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
You guys can advance that one slide. And another one. There we go. We're going to start our new series this morning. It'll be a relatively short series. This will not be like our other series where we've gone through an entire book in its entirety. So we're not going to be looking at all 31 chapters and then verse by verse through each one of them through Proverbs. But we will spend some time in Proverbs this morning. And when I was praying about what our next series would be, and I was reading through some of the Proverbs, I actually came across a commentary that looks at the Proverbs through the lens of Christ. And I thought, you know, that's a wonderful way for us as Christians to read through the Proverbs. And then I sent an idea for a picture through to Steve to add to the slide. And he actually came up with something such even better than my idea. So he came up with this idea up in the upper right-hand corner of a lens with the cross in it and everything else. And he sent me one iteration of it. And then he was like, you know what? I think it'd be really cool is if the cross was in color. Let me send you something else. And so even though these things just kind of get projected onto our walls, there's some thought that goes behind them. And so my appreciation to Steve for his creativity and his photographic skills and his editing skills to provide that for us, because I think it will give us an idea of what our goal is through this series. So we're going to spend 6 to 8 weeks, probably closer to six, going through some selected Proverbs, but the idea will be to look at them through the lens of Christ so that we aren't just stacking up fortune cookie papers in our cup holder in our car of just, you know, little wisdom sayings that we can, you know, apply here and there, but we want to be looking at the Proverbs through the lens of Christ. And that is exactly why I had Tim read from Matthew 12 there, because something greater than the wisdom of Solomon is even here, and that is our Lord Jesus Christ. So we would actually be falling short if we would be stopping at merely the wisdom of Solomon as projected for us in the Proverbs, because something greater than even Solomon has come, and his name is Jesus Christ. So this will not be a series, because we're in the Old Testament, where we won't hear about Jesus, because we do look at our Old Testament through the lens of Christ, just as he did with those disciples on the road that he walked in and taught them from all of Scripture how it points back to him. So while the book of Proverbs' rightful place in the canon has never been seriously challenged, there's never been really anyone who's issued a challenge against the book of Proverbs, which makes us go, it probably doesn't belong in our canon. Its place in our preaching rotation or the centerpiece of the word ministry for most churches is usually on the bench. No one denies that it belongs in the Bible, but so often we as a church don't ever prop it up with the wisdom and for the purposes that God has for us today. The book has never featured as the centerpiece even of our preaching ministry together for the last 4 years, and today that changes. I mean, we can't preach all 66 books in 4 years. Well, we could, but we don't know how much justice we would do to them. But there are some basic bits of understanding that we need to understand before we shove off from the dock and begin our journey, and that is what this will be. This, like I said, is not going to be a verse-by-verse deep dive into the book. Rather, more like a 30,000-foot flyover with occasional times where we descend to look at the details and to see the wisdom that God has for us. Kathy, in my annual reading plan, has us in the book currently, and I think our current pace is about 3 chapters a day. Is that right, Kathy? And when you read about 120 Proverbs, you get to the end and you go, well, what did the first 119 say? So that is my point, is that we're not going to fly over them, but as we read them, and that actually might even be one of the hang-ups to an annual Bible reading plan. It's a good thing to be in the Word, to familiarize ourselves with that. But boy, we fly through them, and by the time I get to Proverb 120, I'm going, what was the first one? Something about being a fool. Let me get that one down. So we can become bogged down, though, so that's why I'm saying we're not going to do a deep dive verse by verse over the entire book. So let's start with some basic understandings from which we can build a system that we will use to interpret, to observe, and also to apply these teachings. And one of the first things that I like to do when I look at a text is to get an idea of who the author is, and we'll
look at that here this morning as well. Sometimes when we look at different books of the Bible, it's really easy to tell who authored the book because they've either penned it themselves, like I, Paul, am writing to you, things like that. But other times, they don't sign it at all, like the book of Hebrews, for instance. There is no signature there, and then we're left trying to analyze the writing style, the way that the particular authors use certain words, or even the theology that they focus on, which has still left us with, we don't know who wrote Hebrews. A lot of theories out there, so we're going to, for our purposes, whenever we go back to Hebrews, we'll just call him Bob. That can help us to an extent. It is important for us to get an idea of who wrote the book so that we can be familiar with their style, with their setting, with why they're writing, what circumstances they were dealing with. That's absolutely critical to our understanding. But at the same time, if we don't know who the author is, it doesn't mean it's of no profit, because we know that all Scripture is breathed out by whom?
God.
Absolutely. So we know that first and foremost, even if we can't identify the author of every single one of the Proverbs, we know that the author ultimately is God. So these two scenarios, both authors known and unknown, occur really throughout the entire book of Proverbs, although 90% of it can likely be attested to Solomon, which is King David's son by way of Bathsheba. We know from Proverbs 1:1 and Proverbs 10:1 that he has ascribed himself as the author. In verse 1 of chapter 1 of Proverbs, he reads, "The Proverbs of Solomon, son of David, king of Israel," and a similar statement is made in 10:1. Other Proverbs can actually be attested to Solomon, but they've been collected and compiled by King Hezekiah, who lived 300 years after Solomon. And we read that in 25:1, where it is the order of King Hezekiah to compile and to collect the writings of Solomon, some 300 years after the case. But still others in chapters 22 through 24 can be credited to someone known as the Wise, which could be an attestation to Solomon. And then chapter 30 was authored by someone named Agur, a relatively unknown person, who again, there's a hypothesis out there that that could also be Solomon. And chapter 31 remains authorless. We don't know who wrote that beautiful chapter. So for the most part, many of the Proverbs have been penned by Solomon, with only about 10% of them believed to be by other authors. And we shouldn't be surprised that Solomon penned so many of these, because in 1 Kings 3, shortly after assuming the throne from his father, King David, and shortly after his death, we know that Solomon asked the Lord for wisdom. Has that played a role in your prayer life? I tell you, for the last 7 or 8 weeks, it has for mine. As we've been preparing for this series, I thought that is noticeably absent from my prayer life. And oftentimes I can tell by my decision-making. So we pen, ask the author for wisdom. We read in 1 Kings 3, beginning in verse 7, "And now, O Lord my God, you have made your servant king in place of David my father. Although I am but a little child, I do not know how to go out or how to come in. Your servant is in the midst of your people whom you have chosen," speaking to God, "your people whom you have chosen, a great people, too many to be numbered or counted for multitude." Verse 9, "Give your servant therefore an understanding mind to govern your people, that I may discern between good and evil. For who is able to govern this your great people?" Which ends Solomon's quote. Verse 10 then continues, "It pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this, and God said to him, because you have asked this, and have not asked for yourself long life, or riches, for the life of your enemies, but you've asked for yourself understanding to discern what is right. Behold, I now do according to your word. Behold, I give you a wise and discerning mind, so that none like you has been before you, and none like you shall arise after you." Wisdom is not mere knowledge. How many of you know somebody or have had experiences in your own life where you knew something, but then your street smart was a little bit out there? In fact, so often when we sin, we know it's sin. So knowledge clearly isn't wisdom, because wisdom would then be acted upon knowledge. Would be one probably chopped up and bad definition of wisdom, but something like that. So where did Solomon acquire his wisdom? Directly from the author of wisdom himself, the Lord God. And one chapter later in 1 Kings 4, verse 29, and God gave Solomon wisdom and understanding beyond measure and breadth of mind like the sand of the seashore, so that Solomon's wisdom surpassed the wisdom of all the people of the east and all the wisdom of Egypt. The known scribes and smart people of their day. Verse 31, for he was wiser than all other men, wiser than Ethan, the Ezrahites, and Heman, and Calcol, and Darda, and the sons of Mahal, and all fame was in all the surrounding nations. Verse 32, he spoke some 3,000 proverbs. So Proverbs is an abbreviated collection of Solomon's wisdom sayings. Solomon is known to have authored 3,000 Proverbs, so having 90% of the book ascribed to Solomon is not a stretch. But let's remember, we're not putting Solomon on a pedestal here. Just seven chapters later in 1 Kings, and in 1 Kings 11, we read he had 700 wives, 300 concubines, so three Proverbs apiece. Clearly, he has turned his back on God's call for a family. And we also know in that chapter that his wives turned away his heart. For when Solomon was old, his wives turned away his heart after other gods, and his heart was not wholly true to the Lord his God. So please do not hear this as a pedestalizing of Solomon. He had wisdom, to be sure. But even in the collection and hoarding of wisdom is not always wise actions and dealings. That pedestal is reserved for God and Him alone, and in particular the God-man Jesus Christ, whom in Matthew 12 is greater than Solomon. So it is in the wisdom of the Lord that these Proverbs came to be. That is why we call them part of the wisdom literature of the Bible. These are similar to Ecclesiastes. A lot of the Psalms read similarly to Proverbs, and even in the New Testament, we get to the book of James. James reads very proverbial or wisdom sayings, as does much of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. We can read very similar calls for morality, but a morality aligned to the holiness of God. But why? Why do we have an entire book dedicated to compiling and cataloging wisdom literature during Israel's pre-Messiah life? Well, the first seven verses of Proverbs serve as the purpose statement for the collection. So please stand with me as we give honor to the Word of God, and we read from Proverbs 1, verses 1 through 7. Proverbs 1, verse 1 begins, "The Proverbs of Solomon, son of David, king of Israel. To know wisdom and instruction, to understand words of insight, to receive instruction in wise dealing, in righteousness, justice, and equity, to give prudence to the simple, knowledge and discretion to the youth. Let the wise hear and increase in learning, and the one who understands obtain guidance. To understand a proverb and a saying, the words of the wise and their riddles." Verse 7, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and instruction." This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Gracious God, we thank you for preserving these wise sayings, and Lord, may we view them from the heights of the pedestal on which we put Christ, Lord, the greater Solomon, the greater Jonah. Father, we thank you that we could read these statements and in them see us being challenged, being corrected, being rebuked. So, Father, may we not merely commit to memory statements, even wise statements, but, Father, may we look at them and see in them your wisdom to protect us from evil, so that we flee from evil and that we flee to you, that we cling to you and we cling to the author of our salvation, our Lord Jesus Christ. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. May be seated. So this introduction gives us the purpose statement for which Solomon likely wrote the first 10 chapters. Those kind of, or first 9 chapters, those kind of serve as a unit. And what we see in here is these individual proverbs and the collection as a whole serve to spur us on in growth, in wisdom, and in knowledge. But in verse 7, we have the starting point for all divine knowledge and wisdom, which is the fear of the Lord. By a cursory counting, there are 12 times the fear of the Lord is referred to in this collection of wisdom writings we call Proverbs. 12 times does the fear of the Lord function as a starting point for knowledge and for wisdom. And the way of the wise, oftentimes throughout this 31-chapter book, is contrasted by that of the fool. Wisdom contrasted to folly or foolishness. It could be said that fear is contrasted with folly. Ever since reading his biography some 12 years ago, I've been enamored with Charles Spurgeon and his ministry in God's Word, and I find his teaching on the fear of the Lord helpful here. Charles Spurgeon was likely the best mind and greatest preacher in England in the 1800s. In fact, referring to Philippians 2:12, if you remember that from about a year ago, when we were in chapter 2 of Philippians, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. On that passage, Spurgeon says, the fear of God is that which makes it a fear to offend so good a God. Because he is so holy, we could add to Spurgeon's understanding. The fear of God is that which makes it a fear to offend so good a God, a hallowed, childlike fear, but please don't hear childlike fear like worry about the boogeyman. A childlike fear of which we reserve, blessed is the man that fears always. Spurgeon continues, a reverential awe of the Most High, a pious, meaning seeking to rightly order our lives in a way that honors God, a pious dread of offending. This is the fear that is to be cultivated by us. It is not the fear that is the enemy of full assurance. It's not a fear that says, do this and you won't be saved. It's a do this and don't do this so you don't trespass on God's holiness. Oh, do we need to grow in our understanding of God's holiness? And hopefully we will begin to broaden our horizons of God's holiness as we understand the fear of the Lord. And that is the point of many of the proverbs we have for us. We're wise when we walk in righteousness and a fool when we walk in the way of evil. And so often we can be drunk with the foolishness of evil to where we blind ourselves or we numb ourselves to the fact that we're trespassing on God's holiness, his perfection. His holiness being trespassed upon is exactly why Christ had to go to the cross. So that we could be satisfied in God's eyes, so that God could satisfy our debt, and so that the wrath reserved for trespassing on his holiness could be satisfied and could be poured out and absorbed on Jesus Christ. I can better fear the Lord when I look at the cross and see Christ standing stapled there in my place. Oh, why would I want to add to his torment? Why would I want to trespass on God's holiness? He's paid out his price. My price for me. So it is a reverential awe that should begin our understanding of these proverbs. So Proverbs 1:7 will serve as the foundation or the cornerstone that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. And not a fear of I'm a scared of the dark or I'm a scared of the boogeyman, but a reverential awe. That is an attitude of reverence to the Lord. Verse 7 tells us that this particular fear or reverential awe is the beginning of knowledge. In the Hebrew dictionary I consulted expanded on the fear, on this definition of fear, by stating that it is a knowledge spoken of specifically. It's the knowledge of God. So this fear or reverential awe of God is this growing knowledge of God, and that is the beginning of wisdom and knowledge. The instruction of wisdom is to hate evil, and it involves departing evil. That's the fear. The fear is that we run from evil. In fact, the fear is we fear evil because of what it is to God. It's a trespassing on his holiness. It's a sin against him. It's not a mistake or a boo-boo. Mistakes mean do better. Sins mean we've trespassed into God's holiness. So this fear is a reverential awe of the Lord that inspires us, and then we see that revealed in the Word as that reveals for us God's truth. Character. The more we know about God, particularly about His perfect holiness, which is indescribable in His totality, we can't ever fully describe God's holiness, which is why the angels in Isaiah 6 and the beasts or the creatures in Revelation 4 just say, holy, holy, holy. That is the fear of the Lord, is to depart from evil and to hate that which is evil. And that had me thinking about the Garden of Eden. Adam and Eve existed in their very good creation state, caring for, having dominion over the earth and its creatures, thriving in God's very good garden. They were given every single tree from which Adam could eat, except one. Genesis 2 has God commanding Adam to eat from every tree of the garden. You've got every single one, but one. But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it you shall surely die, or dying you will die. The fear of the Lord is to hate evil, is to depart from evil, it is to stay away from that tree. That's reverential awe, that's saying, God, I trust you, I understand what you're doing here, you're keeping me from holiness, you're allowing me to show you worship by running from holiness, from evil and continuing in the good things that you have for me. You've not cordoned off something from me that is good for me. We lie to ourselves all the time. That's good for me. God's keeping me from something that satisfies some desire in my heart. I really want to do that. It must be good because I really want to do that. God has not cordoned off something from you that is actually good for you. He's protecting you. That's the fear of the Lord. One of the best lies of Satan to say, God, did God really say, take and eat? The fear of the Lord is to hate evil, it's to depart from evil. And there in the garden, wisdom and knowledge simply told Adam, out of reverence for the Lord, a trusting in the Lord and His good plans for your life, do what God said and avoid evil. Depart from evil, don't go near the tree. I'm adding to it because I'm actually doing what Eve did here in a second. Don't go near the tree, which might be wise. God sees that it's not good for man to be alone, and so He causes a deep sleep to come over Adam, and from Adam's side He takes a rib, and from Adam's rib He forms Eve. Adam now has a chance to pass on pure wisdom in the fear of the Lord. He has a chance to steward his wife well and to say, this is what God told me, we can eat of everything. Every fruit of the tree. Imagine what that tasted like. The physical pleasure alone, but that one. Hey, Eve, God said, eat from every tree but that tree. The one that is the knowledge of good and evil. We cannot eat or we will surely die. Of course, this teaching moment is not described in the Bible, but in some form it had to have taken place because when the serpent comes in chapter 3, we see Eve has been given some knowledge, but it's not complete. And in fact, it's not even accurate. Eve tells the serpent who's questioning God's authority, the serpent who has no respect for the fear of the Lord, who has no reverential awe of the Lord, and Eve tells him, God said, you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the midst of the garden, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. Nowhere did God say not to touch it. Of course, that's wisdom. That's great advice, but it's not accurate. Yes, it's wise to not even touch the fruit of that tree, given its lethal consequences, but also notice she did not even name the tree. The tree that's in the midst of the garden. Did Adam, who had a classroom of one, not even tell her the name? Which is important to understanding the prohibition that the tree was the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and up to that point, everything, even creation, testified it to the very good nature of God. Everything in the garden was very good. Except for the fruit of the tree, which provided potentially the knowledge of good and evil. After the serpent, whom we learn is Satan, tempts her further, Moses records in Genesis 3:6, so that when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate. Don't provide Adam a way out. Don't put this all on Eve. Adam's right there. Mister, I received from the word, from the mouth of the Lord, the exact prohibition that I have. And Adam's just kind of doing one of these numbers. Man, it's getting kind of rough. Oh, she's touching the tree. She's grabbed the fruit. And he says nothing. Adam was there the entire time. The god of the belly, the tree was good for food to eat. The god of attractiveness, it was a delight to the eyes. And the god of pride, it's going to make me wise, had entered the garden that day. And the sin in the garden was not just when her teeth pierced the flesh of that fruit. It was born in her heart, and likely in Adam's already, when her heart was steered under her husband's watchful eye toward the god of self. Mechanical fear, don't eat, don't touch, stopped nothing. Don't go there, stopped nothing. Mechanical fear, don't get caught, beware. May limit your sinful manifestations, the actual sins you commit, but mechanical fear only curtails behavior. God's prohibition was that Adam and consequently Eve should fear the Lord, standing in his very good creation in the midst of his very good garden with everything they needed. They had no deficit, nothing whatsoever, everything under their control, including an intimate relationship of walking with God in the garden in the cool of the morning. Oh, the day we get to experience that. That is the true fear of the Lord. Be in reverential awe of your Creator God, to whom you owe everything and your waking breath, and show him honor and praise by doing what he asks. And they had just one prohibition. There is knowledge that is for God alone, and at this point in creation, we can put together texts from Ezekiel 28 and Isaiah 14 that Satan had already been cast down to the earth at this point in the garden, and here he has embodied the serpent. So evil was on the scene, selfishness, pride, and arrogance were on the scene, sin was on the scene, trespassing on God's holiness was on the scene, and what does Satan do? Like a bug to a light, he tempts them by addressing Eve to take and eat. God just doesn't want you to have God's wisdom. He's keeping you from something. He's trying to keep himself as the only one with all knowledge. How dare God? And so Eve proves mechanical fear. A barbed wire, a trench filled with lava, or a fire-breathing dragon would not have stopped this affair with sin. Because it had begun in her heart. The temptation was pride. Be like God. Be wise. Wise as a serpent. Wonder where that comes from. Sure, the temptation was food, but they were not starving. There was no gurgle in their stomachs. Man, what are we going to eat? Eat of every tree of the fruit, of the fruit of the tree of the garden, except for one. They literally had everything. The temptation was that it was a delight to the eyes, but that word can be understood as covetousness or lust. So when we read there that she saw the fruit as being a delight to her eyes, it was lustfulness or covetousness. It was a desire to make one wise is what she lusted after. She wanted wisdom and got ruin. And Adam is credited with this fall, and rightly so, because he stood by there with his mouth shut. Recipient of this prohibition, he is credited with the fall of humanity. Turn on your evening news if you would like further evidence. Paul would say in Romans 5, beginning in verse 15, but the free gift, speaking of Christ and his gift of salvation, the free gift is not like the trespass. For if many died through one man's trespass, much more have the grace of God and the free gift by the grace of that one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for many. And the free gift is not like the result of that one man's sin. For the judgment following one trespass brought condemnation. But the free gift following many trespasses brought justification. Standing before God and being justified in your sinfulness.
and giving the Holy Spirit so that you can go and sin no more. And then when you do, you got God. You confess your sin. He's faithful and just to forgive you of your sins. Continuing in Romans 5, verse 17, for if because of one man's trespass, death reigned through that one man, much more will those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Therefore, as one trespass led to condemnation for all men or all mankind, so one act of righteousness leads to justification in life for all mankind. For as by the one man's disobedience the many were made sinners, so by the one man's obedience the many will be made righteous. Thanks be to God for Jesus Christ and his active obedience in fulfilling all righteousness on our behalf. He just didn't come down and put on a human suit to placate God. He was perfectly holy and obedient to all of God's commands, namely fearing the Lord. Not my will be done, but yours, Father. And this brings us back to Proverbs 1:7. What is Solomon's purpose? To show us the path of wisdom and the path of folly. He wants us to begin the acquisition of true knowledge, which begins with the fear of the Lord, because fools despise wisdom and instruction. Us fearers, can I call us that? Us fearers should seek wisdom and instruction, which starts with rightly fearing the Lord, which is the impetus for our turning from evil. Solomon wants his reader to know wisdom and instruction, verse 2. Proverbs of Solomon, verse 1, son of David, king of Israel, to know wisdom and instruction. This is a long list of two things. To know wisdom and instruction, to understand words of insight, to receive instruction in wise dealings and righteousness, justice and equity, to give prudence to the simple, knowledge and discretion to the youth. Wesley, Austin, Katrina, Adrian, and others at Lincoln, to give discretion to the youth. Knowledge and discretion to the youth. Let the wise hear and increase in learning, and the one who understands obtain guidance. Meaning our understanding helps us live and helps us make decisions, to understand a proverb and a saying, to words of the wise and their riddles. And then how do we do all that? Verse 7, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and instruction. Is it any wonder then, dear brothers and sisters, that Jesus Christ, the centerpiece of the gospel that rescues, is described as being the wisdom of God? Twice in Paul does he make that claim. The first is in 1 Corinthians 1, where Paul says in verse 18 that the word of the cross, the gospel, is folly, foolishness, to those who are perishing. This is Proverbs being applied. Proverbs were setting us up for the gospel of Jesus Christ. The foolish think that the gospel is dumb. Oh, that Jesus thing, that's just stupid. It's a myth, it's a fairy tale. No, it's the word of the living God. But to those who are being saved, Paul says, it's the power of God. Then in verse 20 of 1 Corinthians 18, Paul writes, where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not even know God through wisdom. Think where that began. I don't know what day it was, but it was with Adam and Eve. Paul then compares the gospel to foolishness. At least those who are perishing view it. And then in verse 24, speaking of those who God saves and how, but to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. Because something greater than Solomon is here. Jesus Christ is the wisdom of God. He's the bullseye that the fear of the Lord is pointing towards. Because what is fleeing from evil? What is that picture for us? What is that turning picture for us? Repentance. Amen. Flee from evil. That's fear of the Lord. Flee from evil. Turn from evil. And just don't keep turning randomly. Turn to God. Turn to the one that we fear with reverential awe. That's repentance. That's what this is all pointing towards. Jesus Christ is the wisdom of God. He's the bullseye that the fear of the Lord is pointing towards. And after talking about how much he suffered, Paul, talking to the Colossians, then he tells them what he wants, and he wants their hearts to be encouraged, being knit together in love, to reach all the riches of full assurance of understanding and the knowledge of God's mystery, which is Christ, in whom, in Christ, are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. What's the point of Proverbs for us today? To point us to Christ. To point us to a right reverential awe of God, a fear of the Lord. And not just mechanical fear, not just a don't do that. Great, you make a good neighbor. You pay your taxes, you stay out of prison, you drive the speed limit. Good. Your lawn looks nice, it's probably green. Your kids behave well, you got a good haircut, maybe. Maybe you do your laundry, you look presentable, you don't smell, whatever. That's mechanical fear. Fear with your heart. Guide your heart. What was Paul saying at the end of Philippians? That your heart would be guarded. That your mind would be guarded so that our affections and our thoughts would be honoring and pleasing to God. So that we would flee from sin, avoid sin, and seek things that bring praise and honor to his name. Seek things that are inherently holy. To really to reclaim, even though it's not our point, because God will do that. Reclaim territory in our own hearts. Let's start there. Reclaim territory in our own hearts that has been lost to evil and to sin. Fear of the Lord is to turn from evil, to turn to Christ, and that is the beginning of knowledge, wisdom, and instruction. You, children of Adam, need a Savior. And the gospel of Jesus Christ is the turning you need to heed. Turn from evil, the evil that exists in your own heart, the evil that says, I've got this all figured out on my own, I don't need this God thing. Turn to Jesus Christ. Turn to him. He gives us power over sin. Sometimes immediately, sometimes progressively. Sometimes, like the case of Paul with the thorn in the flesh, maybe he lets it stay and linger for humility. Keep you humble so you don't get too full of yourself. Get too prideful to think that you're even with God. You can try mechanical fear. You can try saying no to sin, and that's good. But you can mechanically fear your way to hell. And that's a dreadful thought. You can go to hell looking really good with a nice haircut, clean clothes, you paid your taxes, you didn't beat your kids, never got drunk, never got high, don't even have any tattoos. You never danced in a church, Sunday school for 2 weeks ago. You can mechanically fear your way to hell. Or you can take the mask off of your dirtiness and God saves you while you are yet a sinner. Trust in the Lord. Trust in the fear of the Lord prescribed for us beginning in the Proverbs and the fulfillment of that in the greater Solomon, Jesus Christ, because he's faithful and just to forgive you of your sins, to cleanse you from all unrighteousness, and to give you his righteousness. So that when you stand before God, whether when Christ comes back or you go to see him, maybe today, you're not guaranteed tomorrow, you're not guaranteed this afternoon, maybe today, when you stand before him, you can say, well done, good and faithful servant. Because your sins were paid for. May today be the day of your salvation. And if that's already happened for you, thank him with the healthy fear of the Lord. Let's pray. Gracious God, we're so thankful that the Proverbs, Lord, don't come at us as a grocery list of what we have to do, but, Father, they guide us into holiness and into righteousness. Father, they set up the difference between fearing you and the folly of evil. Father, I'm also thankful that we can only truly imply and impart and implant the wisdom of the Holy Spirit through his power. God, I'm thankful that you've given us the Holy Spirit so that we can even walk in newness of life after we crucify our flesh daily, die to ourselves daily with all those desires that seek to pull us away from loving you, even the desires that we call respectable that are really sins. Father, I'm thankful that you're calling us into greater and greater holiness. You're transforming us from one degree of glory to another each and every day. Not so that we're perfect and that we can run around bragging about ourselves, but so that we can boast about you and the God who saved us. Father, may the fear of the Lord mean we're getting ourselves out of the way and that we're reflecting the true love of Christ that you've shown us. the mercy that you've given us, the forgiveness that you've offered us, the faithfulness that you've offered us in a world that is topsy-turvy and nothing is sure and our situations change every other day. But Father, you are there, you are steady, and you are sure, and you are the foundation on which we can stand confidently in Jesus Christ. And it's in his wise name that we pray. Amen.